Pasifika, born a people proud.
And welcome to Tagata Pasifika.
Halo oloketa, aloha kakahiaka. On the show today, Hawke's Bay's RSE workers get a helping hand as their future becomes clearer.
As far as the UK, people are sending money in so that we could support the boys that are here.
It's census time soon, so why is it crucial that Pacific people take part?
We want to make sure that our children are resourced when they do come to adulthood.
And it's the start of the season for our men and women of Super Rugby.
We're really focusing on game situations and game scenarios and learning our patterns.
Tai au manuia. But first, parts of Northland, Auckland and Coromandel were hit hard by heavy rain last night, causing flooding, road closures, slips and residents having to evacuate in some areas. Northland was cut off from Auckland for a while as the deluge moved south towards the east coast, Hawke's Bay and central North Island regions.
And it's the third time in less than a month the regions have been hit by severe weather, with those places worst hit by Cyclone Gabrielle, Te Taira Whiti, East Coast and Hawke's Bay bracing themselves once again. The national state of emergency from the cyclone remains in place until next week, and to date 11 people have died, with 23 people still uncontactable.
Government has announced $50 million in an interim relief package for cyclone-affected regions, with $250 million to rebuild roads. Meanwhile, RSE workers from the Pacific Islands have a better idea of their future this week, with some already back to work and others being redeployed. Some in Hawke's Bay have been staying at community and evacuation centres, but less is known about other RSE workers further up the coast towards Gisborne. And we'll also get an update from Te Taira Whiti and the Hawke's Bay from Napier, community leader Tofilau Talalelei Taufale in our Talanoa later in the show.
Meantime, the Pasifika Medical Association have had a multilingual medical assistance team provide mental health and medical support for the workers this past week. There were early concerns around health and skin-related issues from the flooding and dirty drinking water. Chief Executive Debbie Sorensen says the team helped break down language barriers.
When we are under pressure, when something bad happens, when there's a crisis, it's really important when you're looking for help that the people that you are talking to are people who understand you, understand the way you live your life, that will be sensitive to the way you're feeling, and the real complexity that happens at times like this.
And the team will be based in the Bay until Sunday.
And finally to Fiji, where the Pacific Islands Forum Special Leaders Retreat wrapped up in Nandi yesterday. Representing New Zealand was Deputy Prime Minister Carmel Sepuloni, who joined leaders to welcome Kiribati back to the fold last July. The island nation walked out of the forum in protest over the selection of the forum's General Secretary and Micronesian interests. Other issues discussed involved the Pacific labour shortage, economic and environmental challenges, and its 2050 strategy for the region.
Another looming issue for the forum is Japan's plan to release over 1 million litres of wastewater from the damaged Fukushima nuclear power plant into the Pacific Ocean. The forum has managed to get a stay on the discharge for now, but Auckland public health expert Sir Colin Tukuitonga says the plan is completely unacceptable and called on larger nations such as Aotearoa New Zealand to use their voice to oppose this dumping.
So our first story now, and as we heard, community and government agencies have rallied to help around 700 RSE workers displaced by last week's flooding in Hawke's Bay.
In the wake of the devastation wrought by Cyclone Gabrielle, workers were spread across 6 evacuation sites where they could recoup and reach loved ones overseas. Reporter Anauli Karima Fai'ai visited one of the centres for this story.
Ever since the harrowing events that left these RSE workers displaced, the community has stepped in to help.
I look at the face, it's very safe for to stay together, no more problem for us.
Many of these workers lost their accommodation and possessions in last week's Hawke's Bay flooding, a situation they could never have anticipated.
6 o'clock in the morning, there's no water, but only half an hour, the water is coming faster. And I talked to my boys, climbing up to the roof.
Just
brings tears to your eyes, eh? Just thinking about what they've gone through.
6 Pacific evacuation sites were set up to provide the workers accommodation, including this one in Napier at King's House Church.
And they came in with maybe just a plastic bag, maybe just a backpack. Some were even able to hold suitcases above, and that's all they had left. I guess it's just the grace of God that they've been able to make it here.
The team here doing what they can to keep their morale high.
We had a bit of a volleyball competition going on. Some people are playing soccer. The Fijians are playing sevens, as they do. So we've got that going on just to keep the spirits up.
Also helping them to get in touch with their families back in the islands.
A lot of supporters come in to get some comms out so that they could reach their families and those that are still asking how they are, where they are they okay?
The wider community has rallied to provide support through donations, some travelling here from as far as Wellington.
We've got a lot of bedding, we've got towels and clothes coming in. Some people from afar, as far as the UK, people are sending money in so that we could support the boys that are here.
In the meantime, their employers are looking to get them back into work.
The contractors and the orchard owners have been really good. They've disregarded all their orchards and everything, and they've just made sure that the boys are safe.
But for now, they're safe and grateful for the community support that's lifted them back on their feet.
I say thank you very much, and thank you for the prayer, all the people. He brought them for the cyclone.
Stay with us. When we come back, we get an update from the Hawke's Bay in Aotearoa.
And later, our men and women gear up for a season of Super Rugby.
think we're really proud of the direction we're heading. Yeah, having our second year, getting a pre-season block in, the experience, having had last year's experience, guys are sort of understanding and knowing what's required to play at this level.
First time I went to a boxing gym, I would have been about 15, 16. And then I trained for a little bit under a guy called Henry Schuster. And he helped me gain my love of the sport. And then by the time I was 21, I had my first fight under Vasco. I grew up in central Auckland, so the Polynesian community is quite strong there. So, and mum and dad were very traditional, so yeah, I wouldn't see my life being any other way. Yeah, I'm very proud to represent my culture. We're like a warrior race, eh? You know, our women, they're like, they're pretty feisty, eh? So you got, I guess this is the, for me personally, this is the good sport to channel that energy into.
So on the 27th of May this year, we're looking to put on a fight between Ellery Malicia and Lani Daniels. It is currently for the heavyweight IBF world title fight. This has never been done in New Zealand between two Kiwi-born ladies. At the same time, we're still in negotiation to make it a unified belt between IBF and the WBO. Once we achieve that, that's also going to be the first time in the world that that has been done. So, yeah, we're quite excited about it. I personally think that this is massive, a step for female boxing, especially in New Zealand and the South Pacific. This hasn't been done. We can show it that it can be done. One of the Kiwi lady will be crowned unified champion at the end of the 27th.
It's a huge opportunity. This was always the goal for me. But like I said, the journey's definitely been a roller coaster. You know, life happens and sometimes you have to step away, but since the door's open to it, I might as well walk through it, you know? One of us has to walk through it, so I'm betting on me, and I bet she's betting on herself. I've seen her fight live, I've seen some of her fights on YouTube, and, you know, I respect her craft, I respect her team, and I respect what she's done, but we don't go to lose, we go to win. You know, the both of us, whether we meant to or we didn't, it's our duty, like it's now our duty to represent our cultures, you know? And by both of us going for this, it gives our people something to aim to, because we've got a lot of Māori and Pacific Islander fighters coming through the ranks, and some amateur, some pro, but they, you know, at least they know that there's something that you can aim to. It's bigger than just here.
This is going to be a historical moment that shouldn't be missed. If you're a fan of Lani or Ellery, absolutely should be getting yourselves down there. And yeah, come support us.
Welcome back. Well, as we heard earlier, RSE seasonal workers from the Pacific Islands remain in the flood-hit Hawke's Bay region. Some have started work again, while others have a long wait ahead. There are also more further up the coast near Gisborne, where not a lot is known about them, but joining us now to give us an update on the workers is Napier community leader Tofilau Talalelei Taufale. Tofilau, thank you for joining us on the program.
Tae o manui, everyone. Great to be here. Thank you for the opportunity.
Tofilau, we've had a lot of flooding overnight and been a bit worried about the weather, but I know it's setting in now for you guys right now. What's it like on the ground there?
It's been very wet, heavy rain the last couple of hours. Thankfully, Civil Defence have got a plan for those who may have to be evacuated. They evacuated the Estelle Valley whānau there yesterday, and they've put out to the community that there are some evacuation sites for them to go to in the event that they need to move.
How are you worried for the community and the workers with everything that you've been through already and now this happening again?
I think, yeah, we're very anxious about the impact on not just on our Pacific communities, but on everyone. It's like a never-ending storm sort of thing. But I'm just grateful that we're all collaboratively working together, and that's the way that we need to work together to get through everything.
And since we spoke to you last weekend, you've been able to speak this weekend, during this week, to the people who are up the coast. Tell us a little bit more about how the workers are there and how they're coping.
Firstly, yeah, we have Pacific families in Wairoa and Te Tairawhiti in Gisborne. We have up to 120 RSE workers in Te Tairawhiti who are well looked after, and industry have reported that they're in good hands. The other scheme that they have is the forestry workers, and a lot of them are Fijians who are based in Wairoa and based in Gisborne. And, you know, when you see a Pacific Islander person, you all think that the RSE, when actually some of them are forestry. So it's been able to link up with them and link them up to the services that are available to support them moving forward.
So was help able to get to them soon enough? How did they cope?
Yeah, for sure. Thankfully, the Pacifica Medical Association team were able to move up. They were able to connect with locals on the ground. Tūranga Health as well opened their facility up, and some of the Pacific community leaders up there rallied around them to provide support, the psychosocial medical support for the RSE and the forestry workers up there.
So what is the future now for our RSE workers? You're talking about some work has been able to be able to be linked up for them. There's still fruit to be picked, obviously.
Yeah, for sure. So of the 800 odd that were in emergency evacuation sites, we now have about 74 who are still in some of our evacuation sites waiting for temporary accommodation. Everyone else has gone back to their new or upgraded accommodation. Some are working in the orchards and some are helping part of the recovery. But I must say that their stay in the accommodation was awesome. When they all left, you know, there were tears, there were big hugs. They had fear nights, they had celebrations, so they really appreciated that time together, and I'm grateful for our leaders for stepping up.
It's incredible how everyone's come together. Has that really, in terms of supported our people, it must be really uplifting. I'm worried about the accommodation. You said some of them have moved back to the same places. How safe are they there?
So we've been assured that through the Labour Inspectorate, our MB partners, that they've gone through all the accommodation places of concern to make sure that they're up to scratch. Our community are very big on this as well, so they're right on the heels of making sure that they're in safe accommodation and that they're checked for our workers. But it is an ongoing concern, and we'll just continue to advocate where we think there are issues.
Tofilau, I know it must be a huge amount of work and on your shoulders as well. How are you coping?
Oh, I'm really tired, to be honest with you. I really am. But I draw strength from our community and our faith. And I know that there's help coming, and I'm grateful for that, and just grateful for all the alofa from everyone around Aotearoa, not just for myself, but for everyone.
We can sense the exhaustion in your voice, and our thoughts and our prayers are going out to you. You're really on our mind at the moment, and I feel a sense of helplessness. But what can we do practically to help you guys?
So we do have donations, cash donation sites that we've shared on our Facebook pages. We're accepting all the clothing and fooding donations that have come in, which has been great. And right now what we're doing as a community, our Fijian community met last night, our Samoan community is meeting this morning, and Tongan community leaders are all meeting. I'm just asking them, what are our needs that we need to gather moving forward for our local Pacific community? And we just blend that in with all the offers of support from locally and abroad.
Tofilau, thank you for your time on the program this morning.
First time we have not.
Alofa tele. After the break, our preview of Super Rugby. But next, it's census time, so why Pacific people need to get involved.
Our system is designed on demand, and a lot of the allocation of resources is based on what we know about the population. So when Pacific don't participate in the census, it means that they're not counted in our funding models and that kind of thing.
Kia ora, welcome back. Welcome back to Tagata Pasifika. Now, Tuesday, March the 7th is Census Day, but already Stats New Zealand have been holding community events to encourage our communities to take part.
One such event was held in Manurewa last weekend, and reporter Soana Aholelei went along to find out what it was all about.
It's a fun day out for the local community here at Randwood Park in Manurewa. There's something for everyone. Aotearoa's only scooting academy, Just Scooting, joining forces with Stats New Zealand to bring the 2023 census to South Auckland, encouraging the locals to come out, enjoy the day, and fill out the census forms.
The census is a nationwide survey where everyone needs to complete, and it happens every 5 years. So it aims to take a really good snapshot of our communities living in and how we can support and resource the needs of our communities.
Supporting the event with his family was local MP for Takanini, Dr. Anae Neru Levasa.
It's about community engagement and doing it effectively. So having these events come here, doing what our community like in terms of challenges, scooter competitions, having food stores around, having that whānau orientation is really what our community needs.
2023 Census New Zealand is intentionally targeting communities that were underrepresented in the last census, mainly Pacific Islanders and Māori. Geraldine Clifford Lidstone, who is CEO and Secretary for the Ministry of Pacific Peoples, highlights the importance of the census.
Our system is designed on demand, and a lot of the allocation of resources is based on what we know about the population. So when Pacific don't participate in the census, it means that they're not counted in our funding models and that kind of thing.
Many critics blame the low turnout of Pacific people in the 2018 census on the lack of resources available to the community. This time round, the census team have made changes to make it more accessible and understandable for Pacific Island communities.
In 2018, it was all online, but we heard our community tell us that they needed resources to help them, especially with languages. So this time round, we've got resources in 27 languages. We've got that online also that can support our Pasifika communities. And in the events across Aotearoa, our team will be able to support them at these events.
With Census Day fast approaching, community events like this are being held up and down the country. You'll receive forms like this either in the mail or when you walk into one of these events. Alternatively, you can go online and fill out the census form. For those of you completing the forms manually, the collections teams will be available to pick them up after Census Day.
My team are the field operation, so they are the door knockers, and they're the people out on the community knocking on doors, helping people complete their census forms.
Failing to complete the 2023 census can lead you to being fined.
It's really important to take part and to be counted this time round, because it's not just for us, it's for the future generations of our children, because it happens every 5 years. We want to make sure that our children are resourced when they do come to adulthood.
To sport now, and Super Rugby Pacific and Aupiki kicks off this weekend for Pacific players in both competitions. It's a chance to impress once again.
Moana Pasifika and Fijian Drua fly the flag for the Pacific teams, while in the Aupiki women's competition, Pasifika players are spread across the four teams. Niueli Mawafu has the story.
Stars of Super Rugby Aupiki at the launch of their competition earlier this month. Soaking it all up is Canterbury winger Martha Mataeli.
It's honestly so awesome. The theme launch today, it definitely was not what I was expecting, and it exceeded my expectations in a good way. And I really haven't been in situations where there's a lot of media, so that was new to me, but I enjoyed it.
Mataeli is playing for the Matatu team once again, a side which covers the Crusaders and Highlanders regions in the south. While it's fun and games with the media this time, she's not lacking in motivation for the season ahead.
We did finish fourth, but that's really lit a fire in our team to kind of, you know, turn things around, prove people wrong. I think at the moment we're the underdogs. So we've been gelling together quite nicely, and we have been working really hard on our connections off the field, and that translates to on the field. So I've actually been enjoying it. We're really focusing on game situations and game scenarios and learning our patterns, not necessarily being like, you know, smashed into the ground, but a good balance.
Hampered by disruptions last year, Mataeli is hoping for a problem-free season and a chance for women's rugby to build on the highs of last year's Rugby World Cup triumph.
It's going to be amazing. You know, we're going to have our full format of how we want to play, and there's been so much more support this year than there has last year. Doors are opening for women's rugby or women's sport in general, and it's pretty amazing to be playing rugby here in New Zealand.
Over at the Mount Smart Stadium training ground, Moana Pasifika is having a pre-season hit-out against the Chiefs.
Super grateful for the support that we have, and we are a team that's growing, and we're just really appreciative of all the love and support that we get from our people, and they definitely give us an extra lift.
Energy's been awesome. Like, you know, we were able to get that pre-Christmas pre-season block, and the boys have kind of come back from the Christmas break and just worked really hard up until this point. And in any Pacific Island team, you always get quite good energy, different characters, so very nice to finally get a hit up.
Heading into their second year of Super Rugby, Moana wants to build and grow throughout the competition.
That's the word, eh, growth. I think we're really proud of the direction we're heading. Yeah, having our second year, getting a pre-season block in, the experience, having had last year's experience, guys are sort of understanding and knowing what's required to play at this level.
Second year now, probably going to come with more challenges. Everyone kind of knows the style of rugby we play now. I think it's just that we keep on chipping away, working hard and staying on top of our game. I'm sure we'll get a lot more wins this season than we did last season.
Moana kicked their season off against Fiji Drua this afternoon. Expectations are high for this match.
We know what to expect, and I think we've proved that we can match it with anybody. For most games, we're competitive and managed to tip up a couple, so boys are taking a lot of belief out of those performances, and where we're at now, certainly feel like we're better prepared, so we're aiming to be a playoff side. Got a little bit of work to do over the next couple of weeks to hit the ground running against the draw, but yeah, it's good to get a measure today against the quality side.
One another one. Get along to the game and support our Pacific rugby teams. And speaking of support, good luck to all the teams taking part at Te Matatini this weekend. That's the end of our show. Remember, you can watch the stories again on tpplus.co.nz or TVNZ Plus.
Stay up to date with the latest news. Just go to our social media platforms. For now, have a great, safe and dry weekend. Aotearoa.
Me taki atu paka, kia ora ana e kia manuia.
Koe kia.
Pacific. People love the sun to our new homebound. Tagata Pasifika, born a people proud.